Hi everybody, and I hope everybody is keeping well. I'm going to continue our series of health and safety videos by having a little discussion about what formal health and safety training is available. Now, I'm actually going to read from the current competency definitions and the Level 2 Health and Safety Competency Definition and our RICSA. Apply evidence of practical application of health and safety issues and the requirements for compliance in your area of practice. So it's the requirements for health and safety compliance, which follows on from our last video, which was about understanding health and safety legislation. Look, health and safety is all about compliance. It's all about protecting people. We've got legislation in place here in the UK to protect people's health and safety. That's the subject. The title gives it away. And the legislation is there to protect workers and to protect the public. So you've got to understand the competence. And how you do this, you can have some formal training. So in the Level 2 competency examples, and I'm going to read this out again, it says you can obtaining formal health and safety qualifications, including first aid, industry specific, or nationally recognised qualifications. So you might wonder what these are. So obviously a first aid course is what it says, but nationally recognised qualifications. Well, the most common one is the IOSH Managing Safely. It's a 3-day course and it's a really good course, to be honest. It's quite thorough, looks at legislation. I did mine years ago when I worked for Carillion. I think it was a 5-day course. It was a day a week for 5 weeks. So I went on day release from my employer. But it's your employer that should be paying for this. And it's your employer's duty to provide you with health and safety training. It really is. And also it's in your best interest to ask them for training, to pester your employers for health and safety training relevant to your job. So if you get formal health and safety training during your APC training period or leading up to your APC, if you're doing a preliminary review, get some formal health and safety training, whether it's IOSH working safely, IOSH managing safely. If it's a specific, more technical hands-on course, such as a first aid course, the course you're doing, read up about the requirements of why you're doing the course. Don't just go on first aid course and go, oh, I want to get to work on the Resusci Annie doing the chest compressions. Actually look at the legislation behind it, and that applies to any course, whether it's an asbestos awareness course or an internal course. Now, it does say here industry specific or a nationally recognised qualification. Yes, IOSH, NEBOSH, ROSPA courses are nationally recognised, but it could be something industry specific. So you might be working with asbestos. So some formal or even informal asbestos training. But if you identify that you're delivering a specific legal compliance requirement for health and safety as part of your APC, especially as part of your case study, you ask your employer for some training. It's really, really, really important. But training for health and safety is not just about the APC. It's about learning. It's about protecting yourself. You may notice I finally put the picture up on the wall after being in the office about new office about 6 weeks. Did I climb on the chair to do it? No. I used some proper steps because I'm familiar with working at height and the regulations and requirements behind it. So I only knew this because I've had formal health and safety training on it. If your employer won't pay for any formal health and safety training, there's quite a good resource available. And I did a video a couple of years ago about this, and I'll put the link to this video above. It's the CITB Managers and Professionals Health and Safety course, which is the requirement qualification to get a professionally qualified person's CSCS card, which as an RICS member, you can apply for anyway. And when you pass your APC, if you want to CSCS card as a professionally qualified person, your MRICS status allows you to get this level of CSCS card. But CITB are the examining body, and they have a really good app to help you prepare for it, and it's a fantastic revision aid. I use it myself. Without it, I would have really struggled with the CITB managers and professionals health and safety examination, which you do at your local, I did it at my local driving test centre, so everybody else is doing the stopping distances and road signs I could see on the screens, and I'm doing about electricity at work and working at heights and a real deep range of health and safety legal requirements. So even if you don't do the examination, you can get the app and you can look, you can study yourself. But it's always better to a nationally recognised qualification. I work with quite a few health and safety training bodies, and there'll be many near to you, and your employer might use some of them internally. If you're struggling to find a course, drop me a line. I've got a couple of training providers that I quite like, I've used in the past, I've worked with in the past, and good health and safety trainers. But just remember, health and safety involves your safety at work. So you need to understand the hazards, you need to understand the risks, you need to understand what hazards and risks are. So again, we've done a video of that in our current series of health and safety videos. Stay safe, everybody. Again, I've only got the information that I'm giving you now by revisiting the competency definitions and the competency guidance. And as I said to all candidates, every twist, turn, word you write, always refer back to the competency definitions published by RICS. And if you do that and you get the right experience, you won't go far wrong. Stay safe, everybody. Stay healthy. Thanks very much for watching. Take care. And goodbye.